come and to close out another day of worship. We also are really glad that this is actually the last time we'll be meeting at 6 o'clock on a regular basis for a while. Amen.
Amen.
Remember, next week we will be switching over to the 4 o'clock evening service. So put that on your calendar, put that on your notepads, and iPhones, or your... Yes, sir.
Don't be upset if it's real swing at 4 o'clock next week. There's probably a lot of people go down to the table seat.
Okay.
And that's at 2 to 4.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So absolutely. Absolutely.
There'll be a lot of stuff down there.
All right. All right. Well, if you can get in your car and make it here in time, we look forward to seeing you. But just to remind those who may have forgotten. Some people may have forgotten. Some people didn't get the memo. So we put it on our marquee out there. So if they drive by this week, hopefully everybody will get the message. If not, you be the preacher and send out that call. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Turn to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4 is where we're going to look at our lesson from this morning. We talked about the sovereignty of God. The sovereignty of God. The sovereignty of God. Now, when we talk about sovereignty, one of the things you have to remember is that God is all-powerful. There's nothing outside the scope of God's purview. There's nothing that happens that catches God unaware. There's nothing that you do that God doesn't know before you do it. When we realize all of these things, one of the things that should help us to realize and appreciate about God is that God is, he's really on our side. Sometimes we have a view of God as a, I use the analogy, he's a spiritual IRS agent. And in that sense, he's always looking to see what you didn't do, right? Some of us have that perspective of God. It's almost, he's looking to send you to hell. That's the kind of perspective we have. But really, God knows us. He designed us. He gave us everything that we have in terms of our mental capability, our physical capacity. He knows our limits. He knows our weaknesses. And so all these things come into play. Now we're going to read a pericope in Philippians chapter 4, beginning at verse number 1. And Paul is really going to deal with the perspective of trusting him even in the midst of division. Trusting him even in the midst of division. We said this morning, the nation is really kind of, it's in an uproar, primarily because of the election from last week. Some people don't like the election, some people love it. It doesn't matter where you fall on that spectrum, just know that God preordained all of this. I know people don't like that. Let me say that again. God preordained all of this. I'm going to show you that in just a second, but I want you to understand again, if God is sovereign, God knows everything. And God has preordained everything, including our leaders, believe it or not. Sometimes we try to fit God into a mold that says only God will do this because he knows it's good, or only God will do that because we know that's God's nature. But every now and then, God will use negativity to either reform us or bring us back to him, or to chastise us and correct us.
Amen.
He's done that. Now let me just jump into that, because once I get far in Philippians, I won't be able to come back. Keep your finger in Philippians chapter 4 and turn over to Romans chapter 13. Amen. Romans chapter 13. And all we need is two verses, really, in Romans. You can read the rest at your leisure. But look at verse number 1. Romans 13. The Bible says, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers. He's talking about government there. For there is no power, watch this, but of God. Do you see that? The powers that be are what? Ordained of God. Sometimes we want to put God as a Republican. Sometimes we want to make God a libertarian or a Democrat. He's none of the above. What he is he sovereign. And the Lord will do his good will. Whether we understand it, whether we like it, whether we agree or disagree. And so when you know all these things, you can have a what I call a worldview that is not tainted by our human perspective. Does everybody with me? Mm-hmm. When you have a God's view of life, you don't let things frustrate you.
Right.
Amen. Because you realize who is in control. Now flip over back to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. Verse number 1 says, therefore, my dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown. Paul gives all these flowery salutations. He says, you are my joy, you are my love, and then he says, you are my crown. Mm-hmm. Paul says, basically, if you want to know the truth about it, if you don't win, I don't win. I love that because Paul understands there's connectivity in Christianity. There's connectivity in Christianity. What do I mean by that? I mean that I'm connected to you, you're connected to the next brother and sister, they're connected to the next brother and sister, and we're all on the same ship. Now that ship can ride out and stay afloat, or that ship can sink, and we all go down together. But understand, we are connected to one another. God has blessed us. He has ordained us to be together. Now, why is that important? Well, Paul says in the very next verse, I beseech you, Eutychus, and beseech you, Syntyche, that they be of the same mind. Now, we don't know, again, as we said, we don't know the conflict. We don't know what was going on. We don't know whether it was a small issue, whether it was a religious issue. I tend to believe that it was probably some religious issue. I don't think it was necessarily selfish. I think the context leans toward that. I think the context demonstrates that they were both godly women. It just so happens they probably disagreed on something. Maybe one sister wanted, she wanted to have the tea in April, the other sister wanted to have it in fall. I don't know. Praise the Lord. But we do know that there was a disagreement. And because they were influential in the church. Now watch this now. This is important. This is a cultural thing. Women, generally speaking, did not have a lot of significance in the ancient Near East culture. So for these women to be important, that spoke volumes of women in the first century. At least these two women, at least. You know, we don't know what position they held, but we know that they had a very important position. So much so that their bickering and their divisiveness would have caused a split probably in the church. And that's for sisters. I want you to know, you are important. Mm-hmm. Don't ever feel that your presence is not needed in the Lord's church. Mm-hmm. You know, amen. I can say amen to that myself. Mm-hmm. We need our sisters. And sisters, don't ever get to the point where you feel like little things can cause or can be overlooked because you could actually be part of the problem. Amen. You know, most of the times it's us men, but it can happen among the sisters as well. Amen. Now watch this. Watch this. He says in verse 3, and I entreat thee also, true young fellow. We said this morning, this was not really Paul's main thing, but I think it still is good to talk about. When Paul uses that term, true yoke fellow, he uses a yoke. It's a word that pictures a yoke. And most of you all know what a yoke is. If you don't, you know, you can just pull some pictures of the ancient Near East. And even today, they have pictures of animals, you know. And the animals are yoked together. The animals are yoked together. And the animals have a responsibility the responsibility is they have to work together to get the field plowed, right? Now, again, we said this morning, if one doesn't want to go one way and the other wants to go another way, that's going to be a problem. It's going to be a problem. You know why? Because they're yoked. They're yoked. And anytime you have some animals that are yoked, and one has a different perspective, we call it, and the other wants to go a different direction, then you're going to have some issues because they're tied together. In other words, the one who doesn't want to go one way is going to pull the other and vice versa. But the Lord says, if we're going to be one, we have to move in the same direction because we're yoked. Now, give me 2 Corinthians chapter 6. I want to look at verses 13 and 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 13 and 14. Many of us know this passage, but
Second Corinthians chapter 6, 13 and 14. Now for a recompense in this land, I speak as unto my children, but ye also enlarged. Be ye also enlarged. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Mm-hmm. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness?
Yeah.
And what communion hath light with darkness?
Paul says, don't be heteros, so gaos. In other words, don't be heteros means of a different kind. Zugeos means to be linked or to be yoked. And so he's saying, don't you be yoked to somebody of a different kind. Where Paul uses a similar word, but he uses zegeo, which means to be yoked. Heteros, zegeos, means to be linked of a different kind, or to be yoked of a different kind. Paul says, you are yoked fellows. So in essence, one means to be yoked with something that's different. In the book of Leviticus, and escaping my memory, but I think it's around either in chapter 22 or so, talks about you don't yoke the oxen.
I think it's around chapter 22.
But it speaks of how you don't yoke the oxen with, well, Old Testament, I'm a donkey. Amen. Tender ears here. So you don't yoke those two together because one wants to work and the other doesn't. Which one is it?
Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 10.
I knew it was a 22 and a 10. I thought it was a bit of this, but yeah. Deuteronomy 22 and 10, if you're keeping notes. And so Paul's admonishment speaks to more than just not having division. It speaks really more to being together as co-workers. You know, and I know that's almost an idea, and it's just a bad analogy. Most of us don't like our coworkers, amen. We got some issues with some coworkers. But think of it as co-laborers. Paul uses that term. You are yoke fellows, you're co-laborers. And then he goes on to explain it further. Flip back over to Philippians chapter 4. It says in verse number 3, and I entreat you to yoke fellow, help those women which labor. We said this morning, that word labor means it's a athletic term, and it literally means that you're going to help me wrestle something or wrestle somebody else. So we are wrestling an issue, or we're wrestling something that needs to be done together. You know, I pictured when I was younger, and you get in fights and you say, you better not mess with me, I got an older cousin. You know, and the guy, he had to think quick. Don't want to mess with you and him. It's one thing to mess with me, but don't mess with me and my cousin. You know, we can jump you, you know, or we can beat you up. So you, it's always good. It's always good. Always good to have somebody who is working the same way, working just as hard. May not be in the same capacity, but God says we need to work together. That's a principle that's just transcendent. It goes beyond this issue. It goes to us. Every Sunday, we ought to be working together. No job is too small. You know, no task is too menial. Everything we do is for the glory of God. If it means turning on the lights,
mm-hmm.
you turn on the lights to the glory of God. Mm-hmm. You pick up a program off a pew, put it back where that's to the glory of
mm-hmm.
God. Don't ever feel like God doesn't need what you do. Because without you, we're missing a piece. We're missing a piece, okay? Any questions or comments on that?
You know, my Bible's wording a little different back here in 22 and 10, Deuteronomy. It says something about, do not plow with the worker and the supervisor together.
Oh! Wow, I don't know how we stretch that one. You might be hard to comment. I don't believe that was Lewis. Lewis and Jimmy. But is that contemporary Bible? It's one of those contemporary paraphrases.
They're not equal.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What the supervisor has are, you know, the employees, the workers.
Yeah. And you know, it's interesting that you even bring that up because it reminds me, I believe it's in Acts chapter 6, mm-hmm. where Peter says something, and if you catch it on the surface, it sounds sort of condescending. You know, they say, hey man, you know, the widows are being neglected. He said, we, you know, we need some help with these things, man.
Mm-hmm.
He just looked around and said, hey man, we can't leave our work and wait tables. He said, look among you, you know, men of good report. He said, let them do that work.
Right.
Peter wasn't too good to do it. It was just that if Peter had waited on tables, guess what? The word of God would be neglected.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be a more spiritual, injurious thing than to wait on tables and say, well, at least we don't know. We got the tables, okay. Everybody's, at least everybody's fed. That preaching was horrible, but hey, we ate well, amen.
Well, that's kind of like you have the head of the church is being Christ.
Yes.
You can't have all eyes.
That's a good point.
You can't have all ears.
That's right.
Somebody's got to be.
Somebody, hey, listen, and that pinky toe, when it hurts, the whole body hurts.
Mm-hmm.
You're not balanced.
Amen. I told you.
It's also a purpose for that, you know, in the Old Testament, it's such a
profound example
that is.
Jesus on the main line. Tell me what you mean.
He said that the master ought to make sure they rule favorably.
That's right. Because they got to answer to God.
They got to answer to God. And the servant, the worker, versus the supervisor, is supposed to serve as if he's serving God.
Mm-hmm.
And then right back here in Philippians chapter 4, verse 3, it says that pretty mm-hmm. much. Mm-hmm. It says, yes, I also ask you, true partners, to help these women who have contended for the gospel of the faith
mm-hmm.
at my side, along with Clement and all the rest of them.
Yeah.
That's the commandment.
Yeah.
It's right back to Romans chapter 13.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely. Absolutely. In the book of Colossians, you may even think of Colossians 4:1. It says, masters, give unto your servants that which is just and equal, knowing that you also have a master in
heaven. Mm-hmm.
Amen. Amen. You show me a bad manager, and I'll show you a bad company.
Mm-hmm.
I've had the pleasure of managing before and being managed, and I can tell you, the ones I love, the ones that they train you and they ask you, do you need anything? Not micromanaging, mm-hmm. but just say, if you need something, I'm open. If you don't, I'll leave you alone. You know what they're doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder sometimes, we in the church, sad to say, a lot of times we don't understand that model. We don't understand that model. I don't recall Jesus asking Judas, now you, how much we got in the account of him? I know you kind of say, did you take the extra $20 to pay your light bill with it? No, the Lord knew he was an accountant. The Lord didn't go to Peter and say, you know how to make that hook. He understood. He had a skill set. He had a different skill set. Everybody has a skill set. Everybody has a responsibility. And when we work together, it's beautiful. It's beautiful. But when we don't want to pull our weight, or we don't want to, because we feel like, you know, we're the top dog, or if we don't do it, it ain't going to get done. You know, we can have that kind of attitude too sometimes. And, you know, we used to say back in the day, all you got to do to see the church will go on, if you're not here, it doesn't
matter. You're done.
Mm-hmm. And that's not being cruel, it's mm-hmm. just to say, nobody's irreplaceable. Mm-hmm. But everybody is. You know, it's kind of a contradiction, right? All right, flip back over to Philippians chapter 4. Look at what he says in verse, and just a tangential point, in the latter part of verse 3, he says that whose names, and I like this because he says whose names are written. He didn't say whose names will be written. He says whose names are written in the book of life. We said this morning, the book of life is the book that God writes your name down the minute you become a child of God. And that's a hallelujah shout out right now. Mm-hmm. I'm just glad to know. The Bible says, and the books were opened. And the dead in Christ, those whose names were in that book. I believe it's, I love this passage. I think it's, I want to say Exodus chapter 33. Moses was dealing with the seven Israelites. And God was about to wipe them out. God was about to kill them. Moses talked to God. He said, Lord, he says, if you destroy them, he said, take my name out. Mm-hmm. Isn't that something? Moses was a good leader, wasn't he? Because Lord knows, if I did my best and y'all acting crazy, and the Lord came to me and said, I'm about to take care of all of them. Well, Lord, don't hit me. Lord, just let me know. I'm going to be out with you when you do. Moses said, no, I'm tying my fortune with them. If you get rid of them, then get rid of me too. That's love. That's love. That's love. And see, I believe God knew the heart of Moses. Because he could have used his brother. But he said, as a matter of fact, my brother talks better than me. He's man, my brother, he's silver tongue. He can speak. He can give those people to do what they want to do, right? But God said, no, you're gonna be used by me. And perhaps God saw when he fought the Egyptians and killed the Egyptians who were messing with his brothers. You know, he was in the palace now. Well, why would you worry about a slave when you're in the palace? But that just shows the amount of love, you know? And then he was at the well, and Jethro's daughters were there. He fought off those men he didn't even know. See, God, that's the thing. God will pick you at certain points in your life, and I think he will index certain things and say, you know what? He or she has the kind of heart I'm looking for. May not be what I need right now. I got to polish them off a little bit. You know? I say, if you look at Moses' life, it's split in three parts, 40, 40, 40. First 40, he's living in the lap of luxury. Next 40, he's shepherding sheep on the backside of the Midian Desert. God doesn't call him until he's 80 years old. My goodness, what if God called us at 80 years old? Anybody ready to get called at 80 and do some work? That might be a good sermon to preach. Are you 80? You ready to work? Preach that one. Man, I ain't looking too good over there. All right. Yes, sir. Are you 80? Not quite.
Talking about whose names are in the book of life.
Yeah.
Okay. Different religions handle that thought differently. Mm-hmm. Just like the Methodist Church I've been brought up in. Mm-hmm. They didn't push baptism with adults. Mm-hmm. But you were sprinkled as a newborn baby.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But now, at what point are you added to the book of life? Because if you're a young baby and can't make that decision on your own yet, are you automatically put in the book?
Well, I would say this. Even in Orthodox Judaism, they don't consider a child responsible for obeying the law until around the age of 12. That's why they had what's called a bar mitzvah for boys and a bat mitzvah for girls. So it's like 12, 13, I think it's 12 for girls and 13 and 14 for boys. So it implies at least that there is a certain, what we call an age of accountability. And that's a subjective perspective. Some people say it could be at 10, some people say it could be at 8. You know, I've heard the perspective that we are born sinners. So when a child does something, for instance, let's say he's a 2-year-old, and he reaches for a cookie, and he tips over the cookie jar, and it breaks on the floor, and his mother comes in, "Did you do that?" And he goes, "No." And say, see, he's a sinner, he's a liar. I don't know if he's a liar per se. Maybe he's trying to avoid a whooping. That's do you see what I'm saying? So, I mean, there's some controversy to that. And I know men will try to fit their theology. But for me, I would say a child is safe. I would say a child is safe until he reaches a certain age where he can decipher and he can obey. One of the things that God says is that you have to obey. Which infers there has to be some cognitive understanding of that which you have to obey. I can talk to a 2-year-old all day. Do you believe Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God? He died on the cross for your sins. And I'm waiting for a response. And he goes, I don't know if he's a good candidate for baptism, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know. Some people would say he is, though. That's right. Or they'll follow their friends, and their friends get baptized. I've seen that too. And so they just mimic it, you know. And to me, that's scary too, because
adults do it too.
They will be baptized, stay in the church, not fully understand, and then when they reach a certain age, all they do is remember that they were baptized, but they don't know why they were baptized. So to me, personally, I don't take the stance that I baptize children.